I would like to talk to you about master planning today, because master planning, I think, is increasingly important, especially when you also drive through Kuala Lumpur. You have to be there only 2 hours to see that there is an immense need of proper master planning, and that if this not is going to be put into motion, there will be a big problem in the next 10 or 20 years in terms of urbanization, mobility, water management, etc. So I have chosen to mainly work on master planning, although I'm an architect, because I think the problems of urban design on this moment are much more important than making buildings. This slide shows the new TGV track and motorway in the south of France, just next to the city of Montpellier. This track has been designed by our office. You see from the air that this track destroys qualitative landscapes. It is ignorant of farms and farmland that is there. But through a combination of political decision and certain historic givens, there has been a decision to create a new high-speed railway line at the south of the city of Montpellier, which will be a hub between the line from Paris to Barcelona, the line from Madrid to Rome, and the line from Bordeaux over Montpellier also to Lyon and Paris. So it's a very important hub in the high-speed railway system, which leads to a condition where, for instance, the distance from Montpellier to Lille will be shortened with at least 1 hour in the future. Europe will be much more closely related. Network of high-speed railway lines is proliferating. Now, this picture shows you the city of Montpellier, and it shows you the Mediterranean Sea with the lagunas that are typical of that area. It shows the existing motorway, the A9, going from Nîmes to Barcelona, and you see here the airport of Montpellier. And the site of the new railway line is lying here, and the station of this TGV station, this high-speed railway station, will be exactly between the city center and the airport. And here you see, in purple, you see the new railway line, and you see in red dots, you see the new bypass motorway that is going to be there. Of course, we are basically against such an intervention, and the city of Montpellier is also against such an intervention. Why? Because we think that, like the high-speed railway system in Germany and the Netherlands, high-speed railway trains should enter in the city and stop at the railway station in the city center in order to create a walkable condition and the possibility to create concentrated development, instead of having an outsourced railway station somewhere in the meadows or in the forest outside. But this decision has been made on a high political level in the central of Paris, in the ministry. And therefore, there's no choice than to accept that this has been doing. This is typical of being an urbanist. You cannot choose the subject of your project. What you can do is you can accept certain political decisions, and then you have to learn to work with these political decisions. And this. Here you see the trace that was being conceived by the city and by the government when we started to work on it. They made a new motorway, they made a new railway with the position of the railway station, and this is the old motorway. There was a gap of at least 150 meters between the motorway and the railway, and you could do nothing with this area. It was completely superfluous. So the first intervention that we proposed, which was a very difficult intervention, which eventually led that we were kicked out of the project, was to tie these two lines together and make one bundle consisting of the high-speed railway line and the motorway, putting the station on top of the two in a kind of square, and then making it possible to bridge in one go in four places this railway line in order to connect the center of the city with the airport here and the suburbs over there. In this way, we could also secure an area south and an area north of this railway station, which then could be developed in a very green, like you see, and sustainable way. So you see here, you see this this railway station, and you see that we did not fill this area with a lot of development, because we said in the contemporary situation you must be sparing landscape. So if you have a plan to design, you are not going to say, okay, how much square meters do I have? How much square meters can I build there? No, you say, what are the qualities in a given site, and how can I protect valuable landscapes, and how much land is then residual to be developed in built volume? So it is a kind of reverse attitude. We first create nature, and we first secure emptiness for agriculture and for recreation, and then we say, okay, under these circumstances, you are allowed to incrementally create neighborhoods that develop around such a railway station. In this way, you prevent that accidents happen, for instance, that projects are being only half finished, and that you end up with a big plane which is completely bulldozed and which lies there for 5 years, because you can incrementally develop these small neighborhoods around this this railway station without destroying the landscape, and create gradually a symbiosis between agriculture and urban development. You see that the railway station also closes in this railway and this motorway, so that in these neighborhoods you don't hear the motorway and the railway, and you don't see it. It's completely concealed, and therefore it creates a very agreeable situation. We proved already by planning these kind of projects in the Netherlands that this works. For instance, in the Netherlands, one also has the tendency to provide large surfaces with row houses or with other urban extensions without thinking about the demand, without thinking about the relation between marketing mechanism and development potential. And so people plan large-scale developments which sometimes are not completely constructed and destroy the landscape. So what we do, we develop, like here on the left-hand side or here on the right-hand side, we develop schemes in which we first create nature, and then when we have created parks, forests, sport fields, wetlands, ecological zones, then we start to create certain zones in which people can build, so that we always create a balance between urban development and between green and nature. So this is the railway station, and the railway station is therefore also not a high density railway station, but it is a green railway station in which, let's say, the cover of the roof is also part of the green concept of this neighborhood. And so you can see that we produce a reconciliation between a wrong planning decision which is essentially to plan a railway station outside of the city and turn it, let's say, into a more or less positive situation of this new green neighborhood in between the city and the airport. And here in below you see the track running. And let's say on this moment that the plan got into implementation, our office was kicked out of the project. Why was our office kicked out of the project? Because there became a new mayor, the head of the city. And this new mayor was the enemy of the previous mayor. And because of the previous mayor worked with us, we were kicked out of this project. So I think you are familiar with these kind of political things. This is a situation that happens very, very often in urban design. But what I very much, and you have to, let's say, we are not masochists. So let's say it's not that we like that to be kicked out. But we know that we can be get out of such a complex project at any time, because these projects run over 20 to 25 years. And so we have to safeguard that what we design is the best solution and is therefore also implemented. So I'm very proud that I am the cause that this station and this line lays in the landscape in a sustainable way, whether we are part of the project from now on or not. I'm sure that it will pay off one time. So if you talk about urbanization, this plan in Montpellier is a very small example of two forms of urbanization, namely the compact city versus sprawl, or what Mr. McGee, the famous geographer, calls desacota, the urbanized landscape. And it's a very interesting discussion, because many architects and urbanists are very ideological. They say, and either you have to be in favor of the compact city, or you say the generic city is what happens. We have no influence on urbanization, so let everything go. Laissez-faire. We are not of this opinion. We think, first of all, together we can have a lot of impact, like you just saw what we did for this project. And secondly, basically there are two models of urbanization in the world in the future. One is the compact city, but the other one is the urbanized landscape. And if you look, for instance, at the highest population density areas in the world, you will see that they are not only compact cities. The whole area along the Ganges or the whole Southeast Asian area are also the areas where most rice per person and per square kilometer in the world is produced. So let's say the most urbanized areas in the world are at the same time also the most productive in terms of agricultural production, which is a very interesting notion, because this is what urbanists very often forget. So if politicians say, people, watch out, 50% of the world's population now lives in cities, it's 5 for 12, the planet is almost gone. You have to look at this picture and you have to see that at least 50% of this 50% is living in a urbanized landscape, which therefore is, like also this project in Montpellier, one of the most important phenomena of urbanization to work on as an urbanist in order to conduct and canalize developments. So this is such a landscape in the Netherlands. Here you see the towns and villages, and they're surrounded by greenhouses that are 24 hours, 7 days a week, growing tomatoes and lettuce for the Germans. Which is a agro-industrial area, which is at the same time landscape and city. And this is the north of Italy, where you see the headquarters of Benetton, which is a very sustainability-conscious enterprise who at the same time does research into the production of sustainable textiles for cloth making, but also operates a farm, a museum, art exhibitions, etc. They use the surrounding landscape as a kind of broad acre city in the sense of Frank Lloyd Wright's 1934 design, where you have a kind of continuous alternation phenomena of production, land use, production and agriculture and urban development. So for us, it's very important to not be in favor of the compact city and not be in favor of this Dessa-Cota condition, because that makes no sense. What is necessary is to develop tools of intervention that have impact, that can create these urban landscape more clear and more readable. This is a very early depiction of a urban landscape and also of cities. Here you see the city of Munich, the city of Zurich, where I live. You see Stuttgart, Karlsruhe, Frankfurt, and Nuremberg, and Strasbourg. And you see that this picture, drawn by Walter Kristaller, creates a kind of auras on around the towns and villages that have overlapping spheres of influence. It's a kind of potato soup of spheres of influences between towns and villages that clearly depicts how societies in these landscape work and how also development is working. So let's say cities and neighborhoods form in these landscape nodes, and these nodes, they become centers, centralities, that have a certain importance, sometimes within cities as very important monumental developments, and sometimes outside cities in the form of villages and towns that have markets, etc. But let's say the principle of concentration and deconcentration in a endless networked development, physical development, is the same in the city as well as in the countryside. So one of the big examples of big projects to emphasize such a kind of thinking is La Défense in Paris, where you see clearly that it forms a centrality in the whole urban landscape of Paris. It forms also a very nice connection to the axial system, which was designed in the 19th century by Baron Haussmann. It's a very 1960s old-fashioned CBD, in the sense that it was meant as a monofunctional development of office buildings around the central square, on top of parking garages connected to subway stations that lead in the city. You see that in the meantime, there has been an enormous sprawl of development around it. La Défense has become maybe 5 or 10 times bigger than it originally was, has in the meantime not only gotten office towers, but also housing, etc., and has become really a kind of central district in the city of Paris. If you think about this potato diagram that I just showed you, and you look at this potato plan, you see a big similarity. This is the map that Patrick Abercrombie drew for London in 1941 during the war, in which he says a city is a cellular organism, which at the same time has cells that are very independent. They form neighborhoods with a city center or an urban center, a high street. But at the same time, these neighborhoods, they are part of a larger organism in which there's a hierarchy where the center or the West End or the estates are more important in the hierarchy than other things. I think this is this so-called potato plan by Abercrombie is a very important and very realistic depiction of how a city works, And we are on the moment making a book of cities depicted in the same way. So this map we have made ourselves of the city of Berlin, where you see the old Mitte Center, the Tiergarten, and the Spree River with Berlin depicted. We are going to make a lot of cities. Maybe we should also make one of KL and then compare the performance of these independent islands in a larger organism in relation to physical infrastructure, etc. 10 years ago, we got the commission to become the master planner of the Olympic Legacy Project after the Olympic Games in London. This is not the master plan for the Olympic Games, but it is the master plan for after the Olympic Games. In Barcelona, when they started to create the Olympic Games in the 1980s, they decided that the investment for only 3 weeks of sport into Olympics and therefore thrown away would be a pity. And they decided that they wanted to create a qualitative investment into the future of the city, of which the sport venues were a function. And the same was taken on very strongly by London 10 years ago, when they also decided that the Olympic Games should be in East London as a kind of connector between the city center and East London, and at the same time produce the investment for public transport, for sport venues, for amenities, not only for the 3 weeks of Olympic Games, but specifically also for the many years that followed these 3 weeks. So here you see the Olympic Games more or less on the moment that they were ready. And from this moment on, they were planned to become a connecting neighborhood between central London and East London. Here you see Canary Wharf. Like La Défense, one of the bigger developments out of the 1960s. So the idea of this London legacy was to create for this black hole here a kind of pulsating heart that would really become a new centrality in the sense of this map of Patrick Abercrombie, one of the new nodes in the organism of the city, in which we would turn an enormous gated community, which was the Olympic mode, into a open city quarter, which was the legacy mode. This turned to be quite successful. And you see here the master plan of this legacy area, where you see the remnants of the stadium. You see the velodrome here. You see there the swimming hall of Zaha Hadid. And the Stratford Shopping Center, the new Crossrail connection, which connects to the high-speed railway line to Paris with a special station, and on the place of this industrial river where there were a lot of mills and industry, a beautiful new park. This project we developed into a street pattern and into a public space system between public and private, turned into six neighborhoods. These six neighborhoods were all incrementally being able to be developed, so that when there would not be any building pressure, you could stop and wait for a while, like this project that I showed you in the beginning, a kind of sustainable, careful way of development. And I show you this Matryoshka doll here in the right-hand corner, because if you do such a project, you always have to think upscale on the one hand and downscale on the other hand. If you look at this project upscale, it has to perform as a central place together with Canary Wharf, together with Buckingham Palace area, together with the city of Westminster, etc. And if you look downscale, the project as a whole should be divided into smaller walkable neighborhoods that have their own town center, that have their own high street, and that has their own mixed-use development, so that these two things, a very large regional urban scale and the local district scale, come together in the design. This upscale and downscale is maybe one of the most important ways of thinking, approaches to apply when you do these urban mega projects. And this, of course, projects like Canary Wharf didn't do that in the 1950s and 1960s. But on the other hand, these projects gradually turned from a wolf in sheepskin into a sheep in wolfskin, if you like, because they were so strong that they attracted public transport. The Jubilee Line was put underneath and consequently attracted a lot of housing, and therefore in the end started to become, like La Défense in Paris, a neighborhood. And this went quite well until 2008, when the Lehman Brothers, I think they were in this building, the Lehman Brothers bank went bankrupt, and a lot of this real estate became vacant. The Canary Group discovered that they could not rent out these mega buildings anymore, with floor fields of two or three football fields, because they were not flexible enough. You couldn't turn them into small-scale entrepreneurial renting space. You couldn't turn them into living or apartments. So we were asked by them, how can we solve this? And we said, well, the only thing you can do is cut these buildings up and turn one tower into four towers, because otherwise you will get nowhere. So we did a exercise for them on the site called Wood Wharf, which is a new development by them, where we showed that they could create podiums with mixed-use development, with courtyards and atria, on top of which slender towers would follow. These slender towers would be such a size that they could be swapping between offices and between apartments, and otherwise they would be very flexible. The way they would be standing in the ground with their footprint would allow them to be separately sold, so that you would have a more fine grain of property lines possible, so that the diversity of the city would be able to grow, etc. These are very basic urban principles that we applied to such a big development in order to, let's say, teach these people how, on the one hand, they can make a better city, and on the other hand, they probably can make more money, because in the end, the result between construction, demolishment, or alteration is much more favorable in a more flexible condition. This principle we developed actually in the city center of Rotterdam, where I am the one who is creating the vision and the conducting on high-rise buildings. These high-rise buildings are not so high as here, as you know, but for our standards, these buildings are high-rise buildings. And what we did for the Eastern City Center was that we created a kind of control and laissez-faire system, a system in which you fix certain rules, but you leave other ones free. A little bit in the sense of the New York zoning law, but the New York zoning law is very strict. It works with fixed lines of gutter heights and setbacks, whereas this principle is flexible because buildings have to react to each other in terms of view, daylight access, slenderness, and other aspects. So you see here part of this city center in the 1960s when everything was low, and these office areas are obsolete, and therefore they have a difficulty in redevelopment. So we created a principle in which multiple towers were allowed to be built on top of the existing plots, but leaving the blocks and the ground floor areas intact. They were allowed to replace them, but they had to take on the grain and the plot sizes in order to allow for a flexible urbanism that would allow for change in the future without an enormous destruction of capital. And here you see how these towers behave themselves. They are very calibratedly positioned so that their view lines and their skyline function very well. One of the towers we build ourselves, it's this one. It's called the Red Apple. That's not because it has something to do with New York, but because it's red, and here's the former Apple Market in Rotterdam, where apples came by boat to the old city center. And it consists of a mixed-use project, having shops and restaurants in the ground floor, offices and parking in this part, and then apartments and lofts in the tower and in the block above. It's a very successful and markant tower in the city of Rotterdam. Here you see that the windows become more wide towards the top, because the structurally we can have more more windows, because there's less load bearing in the top, so the flats become more transparent if you go to the top. And here you see the lobby with my mother, who is 92 years old and still going on her bicycle. And here you see a view on one of the towers that have only one apartment per floor. So it's a very interesting development, where in the top floor of this tower my office partner Han lives, who has the biggest loft in the building, which is also the highest art gallery in the Netherlands, where constantly new art is being exhibited. You're welcome, it's on top of this building. You're welcome if you are in Rotterdam to visit our gallery. So you see here that we are more or less, we do not fix the height of high-rises in the center of Rotterdam, but we create rules that towers have to be slender. Slabs are forbidden, because we do not think that slabs create the right transparency and skyline effect in the city. There is a kind of economic balance by which these towers all are more or less in the range between 100 and 200 meters high. By the way, you see here the new market hall of MVRDV in under construction. Rotterdam is our hometown, so in this picture you can't see it, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, there are about 10 buildings that we build ourselves in this picture. This is the project for the railway station in Zurich in Switzerland that we also have done. It's now halfway under construction, and it bases a little bit on the same principle. It is the former postal distribution center, and we created a urban design in which all the streets that are in the city center are connected to this area, so that there's a kind of fine grain of walkable streets in the area. Consequently, they close in certain building blocks. These building blocks get a certain freedom in which they have to have a certain podium size up to something like 20, 22 meters. And on top of that, higher elements. Of course, in Switzerland, high is only 35 meters or 40 meters, is allowed to create a kind of density, but at the same time a kind of relaxedness of the building masses against each other. From the railway station to the main shopping and scene street here, there's a diagonal boulevard, which then is created in such a way. This is the building rule that we made for this scheme. So the blue, dark blue, is the mass. Then we cut out the streets. Then we cut out shade, view, and sunlight. Then we shape the models. And in the end, we get a three-dimensional model where these wireframes that you see are the maximum envelopes within which architects may make their buildings. And the colored volumes are architectural projects that fit within these volumes. So you see that this is a typical example that an urban designer does not want to fix everything. If he wants to do that, he kills the city. He has to create conditions within which there is a certain freedom, but in which certain aspects of typology, of cityscape, of atmosphere, and program are being safeguarded. It's a very interesting way to work in such a way in a dialogue between the city, project developers, architects, and local stakeholders of neighborhoods. Here you see the first part of this project under construction, and you see here a building with two of these pop-out elements on top of the podium. This is designed by Caruso St. John Architects, and it's a kind of typical Middle European, I would say almost conservative architectural concept. Small-scale shops within an arcade, here a cafe, restaurant, then the first podium consisting of offices, and then the towers consisting of apartments. Actually, it's not very different than the Asian urban model, which is, of course, mostly in scale, a little bit larger in size. The biggest project that we have been realizing in our praxis is the Hafen City in Hamburg. And I can say that in this Hafen City, which is also the biggest realized project in terms of large urban projects that we made, we have been able to realize all the principles that I was talking about just a minute ago. So this was this whole area was more or less empty up to 10 years ago. Only this building zone here, old brick warehouses from the 19th century, were built. This was the former free harbor of Hamburg, the toll-free harbor in which you didn't have to bring goods through customs, and therefore it was in the property of the city, and therefore could be developed in a master plan as a whole. And you see also here, we didn't make a large-scale urban design, but you see that buildings are relatively small. They form part of a structural development within which buildings have to comply with certain rules, but at the same time they have a large freedom, but not so much freedom that a ground coherence on the level of the whole area is kept alive. Here you see the new Philharmonic building by Herzog & Dömeron on top of an old warehouse, which almost killed the city of Hamburg because it was calculated as costing 70 million euros, and in the meantime it is already 530 million euros. The reason is that this was a monument, a listed warehouse, and people thought that they could keep it and put this building on top of it, but in the end it appeared to be that the whole building had to be taken down, reconstructed, so actually this is a whole new building. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, again, this upscale and downscale effect that I just showed you in the Olympic Games project in London. You see the Hafen City here, which is part of the larger organism of Hamburg. So you also here have this aspect of upscale and downscale. If you look upscale, it has to perform a central identity in between the identities like the city center and the other neighborhoods around it. But if you look downscale, every quarter within this harbor city has to be a neighborhood with its own town center that forms part of the whole in a complementary way. So you have this top-down and bottom-up effect in a formal sense on the level of the plan. You see, let's say, if this is the scale of the master plan, then you have to look upscale to the level of the region and downscale to the level of the quarter. So here you see a typical division in quarters. This is, for instance, the center of the Hafen City. This is the main shopping mall. This is the main harbor where activities take place. At the end is the cruise terminal and a big hotel. This is the heart of the Hafen City. But here you see, between the Philharmonic building on this pier here, you see a very fine neighborhood of residential mainly, with shops in the ground floor that form a neighborhood in themselves. And so does the neighborhood, for instance, here at the end, which is now going into competition. Competition has just been launched to create a concept for this neighborhood here. The master plan, and you see that the buildings are trying to escape the discipline that we lay on top of them. Here you see the official master plan drawing. You see, we haven't drawn these buildings. We only have drawn building fields. We have drawn a black line which says we have to have intensity here in the form of shopping or museum. We have these yellow fields which means public buildings. For instance, here's the new University of Architecture and Engineering realized, and the Philharmonic building here. You have connectivity arrows that are the most important connections with the city. So you see that the master plan in itself is a very simple map, and within that we organize competitions in which we talk with the investors and architects to create their buildings, and you see that the buildings always try to be a little bit more anarchistic than the plan itself, but this tension creates the quality in the plan. And what is very important is that we only give a plot to an investor on the moment that he has handed in, submitted the building permit request for his building according to the program and the competition that we asked for, so that we have the guarantee that he also constructs and that he also constructs in the way that we have been agreeing on. So it is an incremental process in which we control not only the design of the urban master plan, but we also control, let's say, the kind of incremental development by investors and project developers of the real realization. So you see that it is gradually growing, and it is growing in an enormous diversity. And this diversity is both on the programmatic as well as on the architectural level, without the plan falling apart. Now, the city of Hamburg made one mistake, and this mistake was that they said we are going to give out the center as one development to one developer, like in the case of the Potsdamer Platz in Berlin, or like in the case of Marina City in Singapore. And exactly what I was fearing was happening, namely this project was halfway realized, shops were rented out, etc. And then the real estate crisis in Europa started. The banks that financed the project pulled back their money, and the developer went bankrupt. And now they have an enormous problem in realizing this part of the development. It's a shame, because it has nothing to do with quality of urban design. It has simply to do with how you put together the mechanism of giving out plots in development in relation to the size of the area and the incremental development of quality public space. You see, we have very nice streets, very rich public designs by different landscape architects, also gotten by competitions, and this townscape together with the grade level activities in the buildings really creates a very vibrant and attractive condition, which I think is unique in waterfront development in Europe. I think that plans that we also contributed to in the London Docklands, and even many plans in the Dutch cities do not reach the quality of public space and fineness and urbanity that we have reached in this harbor city in Hamburg. I think it's really an exemplary project for me in my profession. So maybe it is so that you can only once in your life realize one project like that as a master planner. I always say a master planner is something different than an architect. Although most master planners are architects that started to do master planning. So I mostly say a good master planner is an ex-architect. So I'm an ex-architect. I do architecture as a hobby, and I do master planning as a profession. And the difference between an architect and an urban designer is that the architect works within the good taste of his own fine aesthetics, whereas the urban designer is the coordinator of everybody's bad taste. And that's maybe even more aesthetical. So look, this is the coordination of bad taste. If we go to Asia, we also work in Asia. We have an office in Shanghai, and we have been doing quite a lot in the east of Russia and in China. And we are now starting also a little bit in Southeast Asia, which I like very much. Of course, Dutchmen have a relationship with Indonesia, so we are not unfamiliar here. My father was born in Yogyakarta, so I'm very interested in Southeast Asia as a cultural area. And in Asia, of course, things happen different. Specifically in China, things happen different. This is the center of Shanghai. You all know that this is the People's Park. And here is a really wrong and completely distorted way of symbolism at hand in terms of master planning. So you see this building, which looks like a cooking pot, which is also really designed with in mind a traditional cooking pot in that area. You see here a building, you see a building, here a building. This building is the International Urban Design Exhibition building, where all the models of Shanghai stand with all these skyscrapers. This is the town hall, this is the Grand Theater, and this is the museum. But if I would tell you the reverse, you would also believe me. So let's say the iconography of urban design of these buildings has nothing to do with their shape and has nothing to do with their program. They are deliberate forms that put together in such a cluster that form the center and consequently mediate a certain message about the city center, which is not really the case. So this People's Park was realized on the recreation ground on the north of the French concession and at the west side of the city center. This is one of the most early large-scale urban design projects. And here you see the peninsula of Pudong, where the famous television tower was later realized within the master plan of Liu Zhu. They're both typical examples of 1950s and 60s master planning, very strongly related to the idea of French master planning, specifically to the ideas also of La Défense, where also there is created a monumentality and a iconography of buildings that have nothing to do with their function. As I said before, if I tell you that this is the theater, that is the International Urban Design Exhibition, that this is the town hall, and that is the theater, you also believe me. And indeed, it is also at the root of the Shanghai urban condition in the after the 1980s, that the French who participated in La Défense created the urban design of this Pudong Island area. You see, here's the same kind of axiality, but instead of in Paris leading to the Louvre, it leads to the middle of nowhere. Later they made the Maglev magnetic train towards the airport. And here you see a bunch of towers that are grouped around this axis in the same way as La Défense. And it's very interesting if you want to discuss what is the difference between my approach in urban design and the approach that happens here, where buildings are standing in parks that do not talk to each other, have an enormous distance, and do not create a qualifying and interacting urban environment. You can compare this this tip maybe with the south point of Manhattan, where we have the skyscrapers of Wall Street not standing on the grid of New York, but standing on the plan of the streets of New Amsterdam from the 17th century, and therefore creating a very intimate and qualifying element in which these buildings have to react to each other and are in dialogue with each other across public space instead of standing widely outside on the lawn. So for us it is a very interesting way working in these areas, in these more or less Wild West areas, how to perform master planning. So we are, for instance, working in Shenzhen, which, as you know, was in 1964 a landscape with villages, and in 2011 is a city of 15 million residents. The scale of which, if you compare it to the plan of Switzerland, with the city of Bern, Lucerne, Zurich, Basel, Neuchâtel, Lausanne, and here Guangzhou, Dongguan, Macau, Shenzhen, and Hong Kong, is about the same area, where in Switzerland live 8 million people, and in this area live 80 million people, 10 times more, which developed since 1980, when Deng Xiaoping first visited Singapore and then created this special economic zone in Shenzhen, grew in an enormous tempo. These are research maps out of our lab in Future Cities, into this constellation of which the end is not yet to be foreseen. And let's say, if you look at this, you see, if you refer this to this map of London by Patrick Abercrombie, you see that the cities and not the neighborhoods actually form on a larger scale this same pattern of centralities, of concentrated nodes within a networked condition over a large amount of kilometers. And if you scale down to Shenzhen, you also see that Shenzhen consists of multiple nodes that have been developed not according to plan so much, as well as more according to chance in relation to economic development, but also creates this multi-polycentrical condition in which the different centers have all their functions in this larger whole. So what we try is, when we work on a project, for instance, we work on this project here, which is called the Shenzhen Creative Gateway. We try to see it in the context of a urban concept for the whole city, where different nodes and more neutral areas are happening. Here you see the CBD, which is one of those nodes, typical La Défense urbanism. Here you see Sekou, which is the new luxury area on the tip, on the west tip of Shanghai, which is more or less a copy of Singapore. Here you see OCT Loft, which is a reconfigured factory complex into a creative neighborhood. Here you see some villages in the middle of the city center with different kind of economic small-scale activities. It's a very rich palette what happens there. And we work, let's say, from this large-scale, upscale view to create this readable system of nodes and connections, and we work bottom up from the community thinking on the level of these neighborhoods and villages to create identity for these specific neighborhoods. An enormous challenge is the waterfront, which has been completely spoiled by factories, by the airport, by other things. You see Sekou and Shanghai, at the western tip of Shenzhen. Then you see the airport, and here you see Dongguan. And then left up, you will later arrive in Guangzhou. And there is a master plan development request to create a 45-kilometer long urban development concept to revitalize that what has gone wrong in the past 10 to 20 years, which we were one of the consultants to do. So you see, this, for instance, is a highway that is already constructed, which, of course, you should never make a highway on columns in front of a beautiful potential waterfront, and so on and so on. So how to create a coastline which deals with this highway? A lot of aspects ranging from pollution and water management to ecological zones and incremental development, mobility, infrastructure, etc. We did a lot of studies. You see here the original coastline, and you see that this is all landfill here. So it's an enlargement of what Singapore has been doing, and also the area in Johor in Malaysia. And you have the same problem as all of these cities, very strongly paved, a lot of building footprint, and the water that comes from the mountains and that rains down rolls immediately unpurified and unused and unabsorbed into the sea, and the drinking water becomes scarce, and the level of groundwater is going down, 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 because people are pumping up ever more from depth. Not to talk about flooding aspects, etc. So we treat all these aspects in an integrated way, which is an enormous task, where we analyze the whole ecosystem of waterways, valleys, relation between salt waters, fresh water, polluting sources, etc. And eventually try to fit this scheme into this larger picture of the whole Shenzhen agglomeration with the airport here, and then create this organism of smaller units that are incrementally developed piece for piece, so that in every stage of development you can stop. When economy goes down, you can stop, but it does not destroy what you are doing. It does not destroy the townscape for the future. Very interesting project. Very workable in intensive. You have to have almost a permanent office of seven people working on such a project on site if you do that. And if you go away for a while, you have the chance that politics have already changed some ideas in completely the wrong direction. It's also very obvious that you will be kicked out very soon. But let's say, as I told you before, that's all in the game. You have to do what you have to do. The Creative Gateway is this area. It's a kind of warehouse area, enormous warehouse area and slaughterhouse area, which you see here in the model. And this is our team that that works on that. It's a area that that looks like this. You see slaughterhouses, you see modern cool towers, you see warehouses, you see new industries being developed. It's all completely irregular. You see warehouses being turned into shopping malls, or you see complete neighborhoods with houses being constructed on top of these warehouses with streets in between. It's a fascinating thing. So this is a capacity study, what we could expect in a normal densification trend when we would let developers do what they normally do. And here you see that we analyze how you can create block structures where buildings that are older stay, that are having multiple footprint and plot areas so that they can be created in a flexible way. But at the same time, keep also density so that you intensify the city in a very fine meshed public space way for the future. This site is also the site of the Global Schindler Award. We are organizing the Global Schindler Award every 2 years, which is a worldwide student competition. And this site in Shenzhen is the one that they are working on now. As I said, Shenzhen is more or less a copy of Singapore. This is not by chance, because in 1978, Deng Xiaoping visited Lee Kuan Yew. And Lee Kuan Yew said, "Hey Deng, look at this, what I'm doing here. You know, you can make your people prosperous and happy, but you can at the same time keep complete control." And then Deng thought, "That's a good idea. I'm going to do that too." So he created, a year later, he created the Shenzhen Economic Zone. And a lot of Singaporean urbanists and architects were invited. And he created, of course, this more or less copy of Singapore, which culminated in this neighborhood Sheku that I just showed you, with green motorways, tendered motorways, with compounds with dead-end streets and monofunctional gated communities, a city that looks in itself gradually very beautiful. This is Sheku, which looks like Marina Bay, as you can see. But which has a problem, because in this city of 18 million people, about 10 million people do not have a residential pass and are not able to rent an apartment in all these buildings that are being constructed. So these people, they are constructing for vacancy and only for speculation. And the people who are producing the economy are, let's say, not even able to live than more in one small room in a old village in the middle of Shenzhen. So one of the things that we are researching is what kind of a policy the city and all these state-owned enterprises that own land in several places should do in order to create a more sustainable development. This is a very political kind of work, but let's say the world is very political, and you know all about it. If we kind of refer shortly to this Singaporean model, which is exemplified by Marina Bay, which is actually a proof of the success of the modernist urban design idea in a tropical climate. You could say, if you would see Singapore, that Corbusian modernist urbanism is successful in the tropics and not in moderate climates. But of course, when you say that, you do not really show the problems that are generated by this segregation of functions, typologies, and an ever larger increase in plot sizes and building footprints. This is a real picture of the relationship between Kampong Glam and the Ophir Rochor corridor in Singapore, where this is the newest, biggest building, which I'm sorry to say it, unfortunately, is a Malaysian development. This Ophir Rochor corridor is one of the sites where we are working on in our research. We are working on this whole area with Little India, Kampong Glam, and so on, in order to let's also say, explain the urban redevelopment authorities in Singapore that their model for Marina Bay is actually an old model that will not work anymore in the future, and that they should now change their strategies in terms of plot sizes and public space. This is a very interesting map. It is the One Map SG. It's a kind of interactive map on the web that everybody can walk up. And you can click on the plot sizes and you can click on the building footprints. Here you see this Malaysian development here, the duo towers by Ole Scheren. And you see here the plots of this building, which are enormous. It's Malaysian territory, which I think was traded against the track of the railway that that they gave back to Singapore. But you see that around it, there is an enormous fine grain of plots and streets and alleys, which is the residual of the former fineness. So what we are trying to prove is that with the same density, you can create high-rise and podium combinations, like I showed you in this high-rise concept of Rotterdam, in which you can get a kind of New York-like vibrancy and diversity without giving in on the commercial value of the size and the density of buildings, at the same time also allowing the buildings to be much more flexible and to be much more experimental in the way that you deal with mall space, ground floor space, atria, courtyards, etc. So you see here examples that we are really testing for the URA. In the beginning they didn't want to have anything to do with us, but this model is on this moment standing in the lobby of the URA, of the Urban Redevelopment Agency. You see here this ever-returning duo towers reader. And we have been working with our research lab Future Cities in Singapore, not only on Singapore but also on all Asian countries and also on southern China for 4 years now. And last but not least, we have been accepted as a dialogue partner, and in the meantime we have a very, very good interaction about what is good urban design for the future, even in such a kind of commercial developer surroundings as Singapore as not. It is not so difficult, because if you look at this picture, this is a computer program that we have, MatSim, which can simulate mobilities. And this is the density map of the accessibility of all buildings to all buildings in the whole of Singapore. And when the color becomes more dark, it means that the accessibility is larger. And the reason is that the position of such an area is more central, and that the street pattern is more fine. You see here, you see the HDB developments, which have dead-end streets and large lawns and compounds, and you have to walk around it, and there is no real townscape. And you see here the northern city center, which is still intact, with Little India and Kampong Glam, where walkability and fineness and diversity also shows that the accessibility is larger, and therefore also the interaction potential of the townscape. So we're trying to at least moderate them in doing this Canary Wharf, La Défense, Pudong Island typology, which is not so easy, because this, for instance, is the whole underground pedestrian circuit that they are planning. And to prevent that these kind of contrasts are happening. And let's say this is one of the most recent studies of the master plan of the Urban Redevelopment Authorities, where they already start, as you see, to create these hybrid blocks with different heights and with different typologies, including courtyards, where there is a kind of more sensible way of build-up and permeability. And if you look at this artist impressions, it looks unbelievably strong, apart from the height, to the Hafen City Hamburg that we were creating. So let's say there is a kind of consciousness to work in such a way. The most difficult is to work on the consolidation of more weaker forms of small-scale urban structures, like here in the Shenzhen village condition, like here in the French concession in Shanghai, like here in this Little India area, like here in Bangkok. We use these four cities to compare these developments where you have creative activity as well as normal activity, as well as art activity, and work out also typologies. For instance, the reconfiguration of back lanes in shop house areas in order to work on this, let's say, downscale, fine, small scale urban tissue. But last but not least, we are also looking at, for instance, transnational relationships. And this is for us, I don't know how you should call this city, because every time we give it a name, everybody gets angry. But this is Singapore, this is Johor, and this is Batam, and this is Bintam, which is occupied by a lot of resorts with a gate around it. And so for us, this area, which is essentially a social economic organism, is a future regional metropolis. This the Singaporeans don't want to hear, the Johorians don't want to hear, and the Batamers don't want to hear. But let's say if we, despite politics, look at the urbanization trend that happens in that area and the social economic ties that relate the footprints of built form according to these patterns, then there is no way around it that this is a future regional metropolis in the Southeast Asian context. I would like to finish here. Thank you very much.